Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to our visiting professor lecture by many people's in the room close friend, including my own Pat O'Gara. Pat, thank you so much for coming to New York. I've known Pat since 2005, when you came to the Brigham from the MGH. Pat is did his undergraduate at Yale Medical School at Northwestern, and then went to the Massachusetts General Hospital for a long time, and then came to the Brigham in 2005 as the clinical director of cardiology, and has been there ever since. Pat is a, if there was ever a word master clinician, Pat's the master clinician. He's won all of the awards that recognize that in our, you know, heart specialty. And he's the past president of the American College of Cardiology, which I think is the singular position that really recognizes leadership in cardiology. So it's a great honor to have him here. He's been a tremendous leader in the field. He's actually, the reason we have the Heart Valve Summit in Chicago is because Pat and I had a conversation in Orlando during the American Heart one year. So Pat's been in almost every leadership position you can imagine. And at that time, he was leading the education committee at the ACC. And we sat down to hatch a plan to try and have a meeting that would combine surgery and cardiology together. And that meeting now, I think, is in its 12th or 13th year. And it's a real mainstay between the American Association for Thoracic Surgery and the ACC. So it shows you the kind of forward thinking that he has. And also the partnership. We always say Pat's a cardiac surgeon. He's one of these guys that really understands cardiac surgeons and loves to work with them. And I believe his lecture today is going to expound on that. Pat's going to tell us a little bit about his really dynamic work and very important work, bringing some evidence base to what we're doing in cardiac surgery right now. So with that introduction, Pat, it's a great honor to have you here. I'll turn the floor over to you.
Thank you very much, David. Can you all hear me with the lavalier mic? I think we're all set. I may walk around a little bit so as not to ignore the left-hand side of the audience. I want to thank everyone for coming. I want to thank David for this opportunity. I want to thank Dr. Fuster for the vision and mentoring that he provided to me some 25 years ago, 26 years ago. And mostly I'd like to thank Teresa, who has been my friend on the telephone for many, many years, and with whom you can actually develop a special bond as a cardiologist referring to an office of cardiac surgeons. So, you know, surgeons are usually in the operating room, right? If you're not in the operating room, something's wrong. So the people that answer your phones are your face to the world. And we as cardiologists, especially when we're struggling and we're just getting started, if we don't have a good relationship with the people that answer your phones, we just can't get our patients to the right surgeons. Just think about that. You know, think about how it is that we can gain access to each other's expertise and how important it is for us to have this team approach. We think about teams in terms of nurse practitioners, physician's assistants, perfusionists, anesthesiologists, social workers. Well, let's not forget Teresa, who is the captain of David's team. Teresa, a little hand for Teresa, please. Now, many of you did not join us for dinner last night, and so suffice it to say I got a little softened up about some of the aspects of being the token cardiologist on the Cardiothoracic Surgery Network. And I know that every surgeon in the audience is thinking someone else did the surgery. I did the surgery, actually, and that's the reason for which the repair rate failed.
Both discovered we were moderates politically.
Yeah, moderates. Yeah, that's good, David. So I think that for all of you who are not at dinner, I just wanted to let you know that at the AATS in a couple of weeks, you'll have an entire afternoon to sort of throw tomatoes and eggs at CTSN because Mark Moon has scheduled a session with Dick Weisel and everyone to go through what it is that we've learned or not learned or other questions raised as a result of the attempts that we've made to study surgery prospectively. So I'm sure you can hold your comments until that time, but if you'd like to do any of the further we had a back and forth. We had a frank discussion between the parties, and I hope that actually we can continue it. So it's great, David. Thank you so much for allowing me to come back. I'd like to go back a few years sort of try to put into perspective how it is that a practicing general clinical cardiologist views our mutual specialties and how exciting I think this particular time is in the evolution of our joint practice. This, of course, is a very well-quoted and oftentimes cited review that was put together by some people at the Duke Clinical Research Institute, the DCRI, plus Sid Smith. It's now about 7 years of age in terms of its publication duration. And it pointed out some time ago, as you can see, that there are a lot of recommendations for clinical practice that populate the cardiology guidelines, lots of recommendations, but about 10% of them are actually supported by evidence that would be considered grade A. And that usually means more than one rigorously performed prospective randomized clinical trial. And I think a lot of people are quick to latch on to this to say, you don't know what you're talking about. Guideline development is still really trying to get together some thought leaders in a room, and whoever shouts the loudest at the end of the day carries the conversation. Where I would look at this and say that we have this enormous opportunity to try to populate our guidelines with evidence that would be considered valid and accurate and appropriate. And I think that is a call to action to all of us. Even someone like myself, who's relatively a late comer in this field of clinical investigation and hopefully translational investigation, which I do think is a little bit of the future. Now, I'm sure that all of you recognize this word syntax, and it would be interesting to see in our own practices now the degree to which this particular set of observations has influenced your practice. Does it influence your practice, you think? Do you develop a syntax score for every coronary angiogram? Do you report the syntax score on the cath report? So I would guess that you're one of the minority hospitals in the United States that reports the syntax score. Okay? And with the syntax score reported, do you think that that has helped your conversations with patients regarding their choices for coronary revascularization? Does that help them? Do they have a better understanding that the sicker they are, the more coronary disease they have, the likelihood is higher that they would do much better with surgery compared with PCI? Is that right? Okay. And are your patients so sick, though, that you look at them and say, you know, you're sick enough, I think you should have a PCI? And so what's happening in our practice, of course, is that those in the highest tertile of syntax scores are more routinely referred for PCI than they are for CABG. In the current era of public reporting, and because, of course, everyone can take pot shots at this extraordinary study and say that it's now extremely limited in the 21st century by virtue of the fact that PCI was done with first-generation drug-eluting stents compared to current-generation drug-eluting stents, which are much better with regard to incidence of stent thrombosis as well as the incidence of restenosis. And there was really no attempt made by interventional operators in this particular study to achieve the holy grail, namely complete revascularization. Well, now, of course, it's relatively routine that we're spending hours in the cath lab with things called a chronic total occlusion. Right? So something's wrong with this equation. And then lastly, it seems to me that there's been a lot of advances in cardiac surgery when it comes to routine coronary revascularization, haven't there? been lots of advances. So, for example, there's hybrid coronary revascularization, where we need to study whether or not having an arterial graft to your LAD plus a drug-eluting stent to non-LAD vessels would be as good or better than putting saphenous vein grafts or other arterial conduits on other vessels. And there are a lot of single-center observational studies on both sides of that equation, but this is an area, I think, that's also very ripe for research, and John Puskas and others have been leading this particular area for some time. So I think that our ability to translate into practice the results of clinical trials like this is a very dynamic proposition, isn't it? It would actually not be intellectually honest to say we treat all patients like this in 2016. And I think public reporting and an aversion for high-risk procedures has actually driven a lot of this kind of revascularization back to the interventionalist. And that's just an observation in the state of Massachusetts. When you go on a watch list, namely your PCI program is more hazardous than other PCI programs in your state, you begin to look at your referral sources, right? And our referral sources for complex PCI also include patients with thrombocytopenia, metastatic cancer, and immunocompromised states. A lot of the people I'm sure that you view as an angiogram coming to you, do you think you should take this patient on? Of course you shouldn't. So not everybody, I think, fits into these neat buckets. Some real-world things get in the way. So I like to point out what I think may have been one of the first randomized trials at the intersection between our specialties. And I like to point this out because I recall that Dr. Fuster brought this to my attention probably, I think, Valentin, 15 years before this was even published. So this is the proposition that you could give someone aspirin and reduce the risk of embolic events in the context of endocarditis. And to this day, I still have clinical questions from neurologists specifically as to whether patients with endocarditis and vegetation should receive antithrombotic therapy to reduce the rate of embolization. Now, that, of course, is not even close to being appropriate, unless, of course, you have endocarditis in the context of, say, a cancer. If you have a non-infective or if you have thrombotic endocarditis, the Lippmann-Sachs endocarditis that comes with a mucin-producing adenocarcinoma, usually in the belly, sometimes renal cell cancer. So this study was relatively small, right? 115 patients randomized to aspirin against placebo, and actually there was a numerical trend showing an excess hazard with aspirin, an increase in the risk of embolic events, as well as an increase in the risk of bleeding. So we've revisited this recently, haven't we? An increase in the risk of embolic events and an increase in the risk of bleeding when we gave people dabigatran in massive doses with mechanical heart valve prostheses, right? So an example, I think, of, well, we need to learn from the past, and we need to probably be a little bit smarter about how it is we design trials going forward. So here's the proposition. So this person doesn't have much in the way of mitral regurgitation or mitral stenosis, doesn't have heart failure, and has negative blood cultures after several days of antibiotics. So what would you do with this patient? Is this a candidate for prophylactic surgery to prevent the risk of embolization, and if so, why? How many people would just operate on this? If I told you, let's just say on a scale of sickness, a scale of 0 to 10, where 10 is bad, he's an 8. Been in the hospital for 38 days, has a line in place, multiple antibiotics, some fungus in his bloodstream, eyes don't work very well. Are you going to do a prophylactic operation to prevent the risk of embolization? If you saw this sight unseen, you'd say, yeah, I'd probably take this on. He's got this enormous vegetation, and we think we know from other studies that a vegetation size of more than 15 millimeters equates with a higher risk of death over the next year. Death, not just stroke, but death. But we've moved very rapidly in the direction of more aggressive surgery in the acute phase of endocarditis, haven't we? We're more comfortable with surgery. Question is, to what extent have we actually demonstrated that that reduces complications of endocarditis, leads to a longer life free of free of problems related to the prosthesis. So here's a study by one of the leaders in the field. Really, what he did here was to simply aggregate all of the single-center observational studies that attempts to show a relationship between the performance of early surgery. It must be incredibly biased, don't you think? So how would you select patients for early surgery? They got to be pretty healthy. Otherwise, I don't think you guys are interested in them when they're not healthy, right? So it's like throwing a match on a gasoline. And in-hospital mortality, but this, I think, has driven a lot of thinking about becoming increasingly aggressive about endocarditis surgery acutely. As you can see here, there's this inverse relationship between an increasing proportion of early surgery and better hospital outcomes in patients referred to centers with an interest in this. And then, of course, another randomized trial. And I think this has also driven a lot of thinking as well as clinical activity. This is a study that was performed in Korea, right? Seoul, Korea, from a center, I believe, that has always been out in front with regard to early surgery, whether it's asymptomatic aortic stenosis, asymptomatic primary mitral valve disease, Dr. Kang. So here you have people admitted to a hospital in Korea, a single center, right? Probably less than 100 patients in this trial, fewer than 80 patients in this trial. And the endpoint would be hospital death or embolic event over 6 weeks, showing this enormous difference in favor of early surgery in patients who were assigned to early surgery compared to those who were assigned to a conservative strategy. Now, as it turns out in this study, the average age of patients is 48. So what would be your average age in operating on patients with endocarditis in the United States? Probably late 60s, early 70s. So as the incidence of endocarditis has increased, it has paralleled the increase in the aging of the population, as well as the fact that these folks come and they have lots of hardware in their systems, right? Or they have diabetes, or they have end-stage renal disease. So I'd say 60% are men, average age less than 50. And all of the patients in this trial had either severe aortic regurgitation or severe mitral regurgitation, a vegetation that exceeded a centimeter in size, and 50% of them had a clinical embolus on the day of admission. That would seem to me to be an indication for surgery according to current guidelines. And so, I think the only reason I'm pointing this out is to underscore the fact that we have to be careful about the assumptions we make with regard to clinical trials and the degree to which it should influence practice locally. I don't think anybody would disagree that we seem to be better off now that we are more comfortable collectively in operating on patients earlier in their course. But I'm not sure that this is the stand-up trial that would substantiate that inclination, because this is very difficult, I think, to translate to what goes on in our practices. Injection drug use, or an infected pacemaker, or an ICD, or a mechanical valve. Now, this is the question I like to pose to David, as well as to Valentin and Jagat, and because I think we're headed in this direction, and I think it's pretty complicated. Do you think that we can actually perform a randomized trial of intervention? I just say intervention, not surgery. Right, for severe asymptomatic valvular heart disease. This is the direction we're going in, isn't it? Because your results are so good, and people are nervous waiting. I don't know if it's more complicated than that, right? So we're all nervous waiting now. Murmurs are louder, right? Gradients are higher. Jet velocities are higher. What am I going to do? What happens? And people still seem to do okay if you follow them carefully with even severe aortic stenosis. But you guys are getting so good, you're pushing the barometer, I think, further and further towards the earlier stages of natural history. I still think there's some equipoise out there. I would imagine you detect that from your referring cardiologist. Some are more confident of waiting and watching than others. Of course, the patient may have equipoise. They, he or she, could be scared to death. And how is it that you actually achieve informed consent when speaking to a patient about, well, if you go down pathway A, it's called an incision in your chest, general anesthesia, cardiopulmonary bypass, a 30% risk of atrial fibrillation, a 5-day hospital stay, and then maybe a little fever, pleural effusions, and you're going to feel crummy for 6 weeks. You got to stay out of work, and then maybe you can go to cardiac rehab against, well, I'll just see you in 6 months. So that's kind of a difficult interchange, isn't it? Especially if you're biased to begin with. And then, of course, there's this issue of trial size, duration, cost, and what are the appropriate endpoints? Because from a cardiologist's point of view, the appropriate endpoint is death, right? Or heart failure, or onset of a clinically significant arrhythmia or other complication. If you took a population of free-range chickens and followed them over 10 years, that's going to be a lot of people, and that's going to cost a lot of money. Do you think that transcatheter therapies are going to alter this paradigm? We're getting pretty good at this stuff, right? The we, of course, is the cardiologists and the surgeons. It's not the cardiologists that I'm speaking about here. We're getting very good at this, right? We have stroke rates that are 1% or hospital mortality rates that are 1% in certain trials. Again, the trials are really good, but if you look at what this experience is in the United States, hospital mortality rates are about 4 to 5 times higher than they are reported in the partner suite of trials. Right? That brings up another question, of course. How many programs do we need? Okay. You've been down this road before. But this is really starting to gain some further traction. Valentin was nice enough to publish this study-level meta-analysis that I participated in earlier this year. And we actually looked assiduously at every trial or every single, not really a trial, but every observational study about asymptomatic aortic stenosis surgery or watchful waiting, and found this particular suggestion of a treatment effect and confidence intervals for an early surgical approach. And I think the drumbeat is getting louder, again, I think, in deference to the fact that our cardiac surgery colleagues, our anesthesiologists, our perfusionists, our ICU folks have really, really made a difference in terms of getting patients through more safely. I like to show this because I think when we're talking about asymptomatic patients, there's clearly a risk-benefit analysis, and there are lots of things, very complex things, that are very difficult to achieve in a 45-minute conversation with a person who's from out of state. And then, of course, they have to leave because they came to New York and it's too expensive to stay here for 2 consecutive nights, right? Right? And, well, it is. Then they're out the door and then you sort of lose that face-to-face interaction and say, you know, maybe you should have surgery. Wait a minute. You know, when I left the office, you were kind of uncertain about it. Now you're telling me I need surgery. And the next thing you know, the dynamic falls apart. And sort of very special face-to-face intimacy, the sort of thing that our current hyper-regulatory environment and abnormal focus on efficiency has made increasingly difficult for all of us, even for those of us who like to talk to patients. Now, of course, I had to show this to David because when I have difficult cases, I refer my mitral cases to David. Now, is this a difficult case? On a scale of difficulty, Ani, what do you think? On a 1 to 5, is this a layup? I'm going to pretend to be Steve Bowling for the next 10 seconds, right? This is a layup, right? Posterior leaflet prolapse, you know, you just, I don't know. Do you want to respect and not resect, or you just do a little quadrangular resection and a sliding annuloplasty? And so how many of these do you need to do in order to be able to predict that you can get this patient through your journey of surgery here at your hospital, right, with a less than 1% risk of death, less than 1% risk of stroke, and have a durable outcome over the course of that patient's lifetime? That's the standard, is it not? You know, I don't know if everybody can do that. I think David can. And even across state lines, that's the reason we still have our relationship. So I think these data have also driven this proposition about the urge for early surgery. Now, I showed you some stuff about the aortics. But these are natural history data from North America and Western Europe, suggesting that if you undergo early surgery within 3 months of a diagnosis of a flail mitral leaflet, you're likely to live longer compared with simply watchful waiting. And interestingly enough, this particular observational study was done over the course of nearly three decades, over which it would seem to me that medical as well as surgical as well as echocardiographic expertise changed. There's also no way to track why it is that the participants in this study decided to refer their patients to surgery. And 15% of the patients at the start of this particular observation were minimally symptomatic. That's a no-no, isn't it? Again, be minimally symptomatic. It's like being just a little bit pregnant, I think, when it comes to valvular heart disease in the 21st century. You can't be minimally symptomatic and manage conservatively. But I think this is consistently held up as an imperative for which we should think about earlier surgery. Would you do early surgery on this valve? Now, it's not really fair, of course. This is your hospital's practice, right? But if I'm looking at this from the point of view of somebody at a center where there's been a lot of turnover, I'm not sure that this is a layup. And this looks to me like this, a cardiologist does not understand this. We don't know how it is that this is put back together in three-dimensional space. We like to do echoes. Now, and of course, there are some people who actually don't leave the hospital with a great result. So this is a patient of mine referred for early surgery because his left atrium was dilating. I don't know exactly where that fits in on the list of indications for surgery, but this is what happened. He left the operating room with enough mitral regurgitation you would have predicted this was going to happen. Now he's symptomatic. He has LV dysfunction, his left ventricle is bigger, and what kind of operation would you choose to perform as a redo? So this fella had bileaflet prolapse and had some neocordy to the anterior leaflet. And of course, we know from the Mayo Clinic experience that if you have mitral regurgitation of even a mild to moderate degree when you leave the operating room, then you're going to have more over time, and that's associated with bigger ventricles, worse outcomes, including this one, overall survival over a 15-year time frame. This is about 1,200 patients operated on at the Mayo Clinic, a good place. So, of course, I'm getting to this other question. This doesn't really fit into the realm of should we do a randomized clinical trial, but I think this fits into a policy realm, and I'm searching for the right answer to this question because this is the most commonly asked question about how it is that cardiologists should make decisions as to where to refer patients who have asymptomatic severe valvular heart disease. This is the most challenging question with which we're presented. We can measure things in the echo lab. We can take a good history. We can do a physical examination. But how is it that I would be able to define whether where I work is really a center of excellence? And then are we going to have the gumption as either a professional society or a community of academic medical centers or even community hospitals where large surgical practices are in operation? Will we have the gumption to try to define this and actually narrow or reduce the numbers of centers that are doing low-volume procedures or procedures in low volume? So here are some attributes. I don't think these are very different from the ones that were published from our colleagues in England, right, 10 years ago maybe, at Papworth. There's got to be a volume question here, but how many times have our conversations broken down about volume and quality, right? Broke down completely when we're talking about PCI, right? So there are lots of regulations about who should do a PCI and how many STEMIs you should do if you're going to call yourself an interventionalist. And there are lots of ways to say, I'm a low volume operator, but I have good outcomes. I have high quality outcomes. So I do 5 mitral procedures a year, but all of my patients leave the hospital, they're alive, and at least I think they are. No, but the same is true with PCI. I do 12 cases a year, but I've done 12 STEMIs and everybody survived. And if you look at the average number of STEMIs done by interventionalists in the United States, it's really a small number, as we have lots of people who could do PCI. So there are ways in which, on an individual level and an institutional level, this becomes a highly politicized, very, very difficult proposition. multimodality imaging, multidisciplinary teams, and I think the big one would be the publication in real time of risk-adjusted outcomes. I don't know what our risk-adjusted outcomes are at the hospital in which I work. We don't meet on a quarterly basis to review them. I don't know if you do. Maybe you do. We don't. I think public reporting may drive this. It's going to make all of us scared. But how is it that we can compare hospital A or institution A or operator A versus operator B? And of course, who's going to write the rules for risk adjustment? So I think this is a policy area that for many, like other things in medicine and in cardiology and cardiac surgery, needs to be addressed. The expenses just keep going up. Now, of course, Ani, I promise you I'm only going to make two comments about this, and I'll come clean about our ischemic MR trials. As David mentioned, being the token general cardiologist for trial design and execution, here's a very nice echocardiogram that I take just about everywhere because, like many in my field, I was a brainwashed cardiologist and thought that if you have mitral regurgitation, it should be repaired. And inability to repair a mitral valve is a sign of weakness, right? Weakness. Irv Krohn, who I think is a leading figure in the world of mitral valve surgery, was the one who came up with this idea that the NIH actually then pursued, and that is we really don't know what the appropriate approach is to severe ischemic mitral regurgitation as defined with an integrative echo score that Jagat and I can review later. And of course, these are the primary results at 1 year. So this is extraordinarily frustrating, isn't it? So there's no difference in outcomes, frankly. It's very, very frustrating. Now, why is it frustrating for you? Well, because I think for most surgeons in the auditorium, you must be thinking somebody else did this surgery, right? Because, of course, how could repair fare so poorly against replacement? After all, repair had become pretty much the standard. You can get your patients through with less morbidity and mortality compared with a replacement, which is a real hit to the ventricle. And from a cardiology point of view, why is this frustrating? I really want to know if my patients live longer, have less heart failure, and less atrial fibrillation when they leave the hospital. Okay? But I can't design a trial with the money made available from the NIH that's large enough and long enough in duration to actually answer clinical questions of that nature. So this is really all about how it is that you would fit rigorous randomized clinical trials within the confines imposed by limited resources and a limited time frame. So you choose a surrogate endpoint, and then all of the criticism, I think, cascades as a consequence of missing the mark or something that would actually really drive practice. Death or hospitalization for heart failure. And of course, this is what gets everybody going. The prevalence, I think this is really the incidence over the first year of follow-up of recurrent moderate to severe MR in the repair group on the left versus the replacement group on the right. So replacement group did pretty well. Gee, if they hadn't done pretty well, that would have been a disappointment, don't you think? And then what was the echocardiographic predictor of not achieving a good repair? The only one that we could find is this thing called postrobasal dyskinesis or akinesis. We didn't find all of the other echocardiographic predictors of a poor response to repair that have been published in your literature over the course of the last 10 years, including the size of the ventricle or the tenting angle or the degree of tethering or some iteration of that. And we showed that over time, this problem gets worse and more people die. And when we looked at moderate ischemic MR, something that David wrote about in Lancet 12 years ago, maybe 15 years ago, we also found no clinical differences when looked at from the point of view of survival or major adverse events. And we didn't find differences in our primary outcome of reverse remodeling. But we did find that repair was associated with a reduction in the incidence of MR at 1 year. Thank God. This is for people with less MR. This is the 2+ MR patient referred to you for CABG. And in some centers, this is a decreasingly frequent intervention for surgeons to perform because of the profligate use of PCI and the underappreciation of the prognostic significance of moderate ischemic mitral regurgitation. Right? We do a lot of PCI, and then only secondarily do we become I think, aware of the potential influence of ischemic MR on long-term survival. So fortunately, lots of people did better when their valve was repaired with regard to an endpoint as to whether or not a lot of MR is present at 12 months. But a cardiologist would look at this and say, isn't this interesting that approximately 70% of patients here on the left achieved a fantastic result with revascularization alone? And as John has been trying to point out for several years, how is it that we can pick these people out of our practices before they enter the operating room? And was this trial designed to do so? The answer is no. And again, another great frustration from both a cardiology and cardiac surgical perspective. We did put together a wall motion score. Just pay attention to the red. This is in people who had moderate or severe mitral regurgitation at 2 years following repair. And you can see that over the course of 2 years, they had relatively fixed decrements in wall motion in the infralateral area on this polar map, just in the area that you would anticipate could be the driver of ischemic mitral regurgitation. So if the area is dead, it's dead. If you revascularize it, it's not going to necessarily help with papillary muscle function, LV synchrony, and appropriate tethering of the mitral valve at the right time. Compared against those patients who had a really nice response to revascularization, and you can see here that those who did not have moderate or severe MR at 2 years had an improvement in their wall motion scores in the infralateral area, probably following revascularization alone. And I think that's biologically plausible, and it's intuitively what we've all thought. And the degree to which we perform viability testing is highly variable. And then, of course, cardiologists are completely confused about the benefit of viability testing in patients with ischemic cardiomyopathy, aren't we? And that's because of the stitch trial. We just don't know whether or not it's going to be predictive. And then we can sort of throw eggs at the stitch trial, but that's beyond the call at this particular time. So what have we actually learned to try to summarize this in a relatively brief way? I think that randomized controlled trials in surgery are really hard to do. This is not like taking a placebo against an antihypertensive medication, right? This is like, well, you're going to have surgery, and we're only going to do part of the surgery for you. Are you comfortable with that? And how you achieve informed consent is really very, very interesting. Trial design is challenging for the reasons I've already mentioned. I think real-world problems get in the way. Some of these patients are taken to the operating room, and the next thing you know, they have a ruptured cord, not seen on transesophageal echo, but seen under vision. That patient's out of the trial. They have structural mitral valve disease. I think the results have in some way challenged previous thinking. However, questions have been raised about the quality of the operations performed and whether the trial was designed appropriately because of what many people have pointed out is a much higher than anticipated incidence of recurrent mitral regurgitation over the year following surgery. So here, of course, is the most talked about and possibly one of the most exciting intersections between our specialties, and that has to do with transcatheter valve therapy. And this clearly has revolutionized our approach to the treatment previously of very sick patients who were beyond the pale. They get great outcomes, but great, of course, is defined in, I think, relative terms, right? Because in the trials, of course, most of these patients have been over the age of 80 years. And if you look at mortality rates, we're really contrasting 70% versus 50%, because these folks reported in the trials are pretty old by the time they're enrolled. And currently in the United States, this technology is restricted to patients that you think are either prohibitive or high risk. And sometimes cardiologists can get a glimpse of that by doing an STS risk score. But other times, it seems to me that a cardiac surgeon may have a different perspective. And as I've said many times before, I would rather tag a patient's risk score to the clinical intuition of an experienced cardiac surgeon than I would an algorithmic-derived numerical result on the basis of the STS website. So partner two is pushing the envelope, isn't it? And it's widely anticipated that we will be offering TAVR to patients considered to be at intermediate risk. So to the 4 to 8% STS risk score, especially if you can do it transfemorally, because here on your right it looks as if in an intention to treat analysis, transfemoral TAVR beat surgery with respect to a combined outcome of death or disabling stroke at 2 years. Very similar to what David reported in the high-risk patients in the core valve trial. Transfemoral TAVR seems to be a good thing. I don't think that many cardiologists or patients are going to be particularly interested in open surgical AVR for their intermediate risk patients as a consequence of this trial. And so obviously the needle is being pushed further to the left. We anticipate approval for this sometime this year, and then there's already been the launch of the PARTNER 3 trial in low risk patients to determine whether or not it's non-inferior to surgery. It seems to me that it's only going to be a matter of time before we actually try to apply one or two of these technologies to patients who are asymptomatic and low risk, as I implied previously. So the improvements in TAVR on a mortality basis and stroke basis actually continue to push us in this direction. Will it lower the threshold for us to consider whether or not an intervention in an asymptomatic patient is ethical? Right? How would you like to have just a little paravalvular leak over your lifetime? Right? Actually, a lot of patients would accept having a paravalvular leak compared against having an open surgical procedure, which gets into this informed consent conversation that we have. Sometimes our patients make decisions even if they're not in their best interest. And it should not be presumptuous for us to say, well, this is the wrong thing for you to decide, especially if we've allowed them enough time to feel that they understand the consequences of their decision. It's all about the patient-centeredness now, isn't it? People walk out of your office and you say, oh my God, right? Or you cut corners inappropriately. So there are some other issues, aren't there? And these are very ripe for clinical investigation, I think rapid fire clinical investigation. So this whole business of antithrombotic therapy after valve intervention. And what are we doing? We're actually revisiting things that Valentin taught us when he was still at the Mayo Clinic, right? So this was a surprise. People say, well, maybe it doesn't mean anything, right? Because we're not seeing an excess risk of stroke. But we are seeing this particular phenomenon in 4D CT and transesophageal echo of reduced leaflet excursion and valve thrombosis. And these are patients treated routinely, right? We're still routinely treating patients with dual antiplatelet therapy after TAVR. And what are you treating your surgical patients with after bioprosthetic AVR? Aspirin? Aspirin, of course. Never studied, right? And as some epidemiologic observations would point out, warfarin appears to be better than aspirin, at least for the first 6 months after bioprosthetic AVR in patients without another indication for warfarin. And that's a big Danish study that's now, 4 or 5 years old. Actually, that's driven practice at a very good surgical center, the Mayo Clinic, where they now put people on warfarin following bioprosthetic AVR, or at least some of their surgeons do. And that sort of gets into the nuance and the variability that we all take based on our most recent 10 cases. But I think it's fair to say that antithrombotic therapy for bioprosthetic valve replacement is now open game. And there's a lot of interest in the direct oral anticoagulants in this space. We have no idea, though, when after you operate on your patients, it's safe to give them one of those pills, because they're immediately anticoagulated. But gosh, it would seem to be great if it were at least as good as warfarin. Maybe it's even going to turn out to be better. And that's another area that we hope to investigate in addition to the tricuspid valve that David knows about. So a few words about research across our two specialties. And I'm going to end with some translational work that I think I would be remiss not to share with you as a cardiologist. So, of course, I think innovation requires three major components or elements. One, of course, is having a creative idea. And then the second, of course, is marshaling things so that you can develop your idea and then begin to apply it in practice. And this may constitute kind of a construct that can be used across many different types of intervention. So innovation as a shared responsibility might be thought of in the following way. A creation of the idea and then turning it into a development, of course, relies on funding. And funding traditionally has come from two sources, industry or government. And we live in an era in which any industry funding is looked at askance, as if there's something wrong with us, right? So that whenever we're going to consider that, we are immediately biased, or worse, we're a shill for a company that wants to put more valves in or wants to put more deflectors in to prevent stroke or some combination of that. And it would be my hope that we can rebalance this equation, because funding is sparse. And without funding, we're not going to be able to make this transition from the creation of an idea to its early development. Think of the people that actually developed TAVR. Think of the incredibly bright people that figured out a way biomechanically to crimp a valve at the end of a catheter, and you shove it in somebody's femoral artery, and then it springs open and stays there. Where would we be without industry and device company development at that particular stage? Where would our patients be? And why has this become almost a venial sin in the eyes of Senator Grassley and others like that? How is it that we've got ourselves in this point, to this point where nobody trusts us, whether it's related to outcomes, patient care, safety, quality, or even having a conversation about who should fund our research? This is more of a policy issue. I apologize. And then, of course, there's the development of the idea, which I think depends on us as providers. Providers is kind of a difficult term, but I think there are many providers that can help to do that. And payers who may have an influence on the early dissemination of technology, and this is the reason for which we try to engage payers, namely Medicare, in conversations about how it is technology will be rolled out, so that they can support hospitals in the provision of care to patients that would otherwise be considered research. And so this has everything to do with the national coverage determination. This has everything to do with making an argument in the eyes of the government that this is good enough, that you gotta help us get started, and then we can figure out how to reduce costs later on. And the application, of course, depends on our patients who are willing to undergo these particular procedures, as well as health systems that are willing to support this in larger numbers. I think our health systems has continued to struggle with the cost of transcatheter therapies. The valves are $26,000, $28,000, $30,000, mitral clip. And we're having weekly conversations about the trade-off of being in the leading edge as an academic medical center and having to pay the piper at the end of the month. I think that not every center can actually do this. This may also impact on how it is that we view centers of excellence in the future. And then lastly, whether professional societies can influence this. And we have to. As surgeons, as cardiologists, anesthesiologists, echocardiographers, as internal medicine experts, neurologists, et cetera, we have to be able to advocate effectively that this is good for our patients. And absence of our involvement in those kinds of advocacy efforts will, I think, detract from the likelihood as an integrated cardiovascular specialty. So let me end with a couple of comments and things that I've tried to do in the last year or so. I've been thinking about this TAVR proposition and wondering what it is I'm missing. So I think everybody is pretty much aware of the fact that aortic stenosis is not rare. Right? And it's a disease of aging, isn't it? Calcific aortic valve stenosis is a disease of aging. And it is estimated that over an entire population, nearly 3% of patients, 3% of persons, have calcific aortic valve stenosis. Over 10% of patients age 80 or over. That's a lot of people. Starts to rival how frequent bicuspid aortic valve disease is in the general population. So this is a big deal. From a public health point of view, I think there are lots of resources that would be that need to be brought to bear to care for this population of patients. And this is a construct that we put together in the third and the most recent iteration of the valve disease guidelines. And this is a reflection of Catherine Otto's thought processes for the last 20 years. Now, Catherine is a leader and when it comes to thinking about aortic stenosis from bench to bedside and back. But Catherine, I think, challenged all of us to think about the natural history of valvular heart disease along this particular line. And I think as a cardiologist, And someone who is a little bit concerned that we've become so enamored with what we can do technically that we're starting to lose track of what's happening biologically, that we have a responsibility to start working on the green box. Because we've failed so far, and everybody, of course, would open the next review of aortic stenosis and read the first sentence saying there is no medical treatment for calcific aortic stenosis. Ah, too bad. Okay, so we must do more TAVR, we must do more surgery, and we failed with what we've tried to do before. So, but we live in an era, if you look just at the top of the screen here, that at least in medicine as a whole, we're starting to frame shift from all of the attention that we focus on disease onset and disease progression. That's what makes us clinicians, right? That's what drives our echo lab. You got to murmur. And we're starting to look more and more as to whether or not we can identify over the course of an individual's lifetime when they begin to deviate from good health, whether they have high blood pressure, they have high cholesterol, or they have some kind of familial kidney disease or some combination of that. So I think the challenge to us as a medical community is to figure out whether valve disease would provide itself, right, as an area in which we could apply these kinds of principles. And principles also that include moving from a reductionist methodology to one that's more holistic and based on systems biology. So here's something that we've all seen, right? 10, 15 years of this. Aortic stenosis progresses over time. This is a tri-leaflet valve. And on the bottom, of course, are the jet velocities. And on the top is a cartoon or a schema of the degree of fibrosis and calcification. And the question is, how is it that we can actually identify the normals on the left-hand side or even those with aortic sclerosis and prevent them from getting to the right-hand side? Now, I was totally clueless, of course, and this is not a surprise because I'm not a scientist, right? I was totally clueless about, in many respects, the pathogenesis of aortic stenosis. And this is one of many, many slides. They all look the same. What are the underpinnings of aortic stenosis? And the underpinnings for a general cardiologist were assumed to be the same things that drove the process of atherosclerosis. So here's an abnormal endothelium that allows LDL or oxidized LDL to transudate across its barrier. And then once it's in the subendothelial space, it sets up a cascade of signals that eventually result in a change in the phenotypic expression of the cells that reside within the valve to the extent that they become more like bone osteoclasts than they do like valve interstitial cells. And if we could solve the problem of atherosclerosis, we could solve the problem of aortic stenosis. Right? But I think we've learned over that and here's another, of course, relationship. Just once again published last 2 years ago in JAMA, showing a linear relationship between LDL cholesterol and the risk of the development of aortic valve calcification over time. And there are lots of studies like this. But this is the reality of where we are. These studies stopped about 10 years ago, didn't they? And they were all criticized because we jumped on the bandwagon too late in the natural history of this disease. So we wanted to intervene with cholesterol-lowering medications and found that we did not impact the rate of progression of aortic stenosis. Aha, you guys are thinking up the wrong tree or you've actually chosen the wrong patients. I think what we've learned is that calcific aortic stenosis is probably not atherosclerosis. And at least in my own mind, there's been a bit of a paradigm shift as a consequence of speaking with another member of the team at the interface between our two specialties, a cardiac pathologist. There are lots of cardiac pathologists. And of course, they actually know about calcification and things of that matter. Here's one of my favorite studies, because I never used to think that familial tri-leaflet aortic stenosis could possibly exist. Of course, because we're all so frequently involved in the care of patients with bicuspid aortic stenosis. And this is an epidemiologic study performed in a small town on the western side of France that looks at a familial clustering of cases of tri-leaflet aortic stenosis. And most of these families, most of them, not all of them, could be traced back to a single progenitor. Now, I can't really account for consanguinity in this particular area of France, but it does raise the question, of course, as to whether or not you're genotypically different than I am, and you're more at risk for the development of aortic stenosis, just like we're starting to learn about genotypes and the risk of coronary disease. But it's so far away, it's still very nebulous. And here's another set of observations from three large epidemiologic cohorts, mostly of Caucasians, mostly of Western Europe, but this particular observation has been validated in African American populations and in Hispanic populations, that there seems to be a significant genome association between a certain single nucleotide polymorphism of LPA and the risk of calcific aortic stenosis and the risk of aortic valve replacement surgery over time. And this has now been validated across several epidemiologic studies of this type. And remember, LPA is something that does participate in the process of oxidation as well as the process of inflammation that can drive both atherosclerosis and some elements of calcification or mineralization. And here's a valve taken from an animal looking at the co-localization of lipoprotein A with calcium deposits in a valve model. Now, we've also known that there some advances in imaging can help us gain earlier recognition with regard to the clues that might underlie which patients are likely to progress with aortic stenosis compared with others. In the original iterations of PET, we used an FDG marker, the same PET FDG marker we use for myocardial viability or cancer, right, when we do a typical PET scan. But if you use sodium fluoride, which has been around for about 40 years and is attracted to bone or mineral or some combination of that, you can get a much higher uptake and perhaps greater insight with respect to the rate at which calcification might progress over time. And these pictures are meant to imply that perhaps there's a way for us to try to detect what's happening at a cellular level at an earlier stage than we can clinically, but that's been the holy grail for lots of things, right? Much like the MR work that Valentin and others have been doing for decades in patients with atherosclerosis. So the paradigm might be shifting against atherosclerosis and towards this issue about inflammation as fibrosis, and calcification. Mineralization seems to be a different process, and one that actually occurs mostly in the fibrosa layer. This is the layer that actually faces the aorta, compared to the ventricularis layer, which faces the ventricle. Calcium actually tends to first form as large nodules on the fibrosa, which I think we've known for a long period of time, just looking at valves grossly. And then these are some of the intra and intercellular signaling mechanisms that have been implicated in this process of phenotypic change of resident valve interstitial cells and the beginning of a process of active bone deposition. This is the way we would typically study a problem of this type in a very linear and reductionist approach, where we try to establish animal models, try to find a signal, and then develop a some kind of an intervention that interrupts that signal, whether it's an antibody or a drug or some combination of that, and then look to see whether or not we can retard the process of calcification as a result. And this takes what? Probably about 15 years. And if you're a drug company, of course, if you go bust, you're out of the game. If you're an investigator, you won't get anything published. But this is the new reality, I'm told, about systems biology. And when I think of this, I think of Valentin, because many, many years ago, he asked me to represent him in Argentina and give a talk about restenosis. Because in those days, we also thought restenosis was kind of a linear thing. You interfere with this, and it's likely to cause less restenosis over time. We had no idea, of course, that life is very complicated. And you make one perturbation, and simply then you begin to set off a series of 1,000 lights here, where multiple systems begin to interact with each other. And very smart people in informatics and systems biology are putting these things together in a hope that clinicians like myself, who see patients with aortic stenosis, are going to be able to get smarter about what are the incident triggers for the process of calcification. And can we develop smarter molecules to interfere much along these lines, at which we hope does portend some possibility for future interventions. So we've just embarked on this multidisciplinary translational effort with Elena Aikawa and colleagues, looking at patients, unfortunately, with relatively advanced aortic valve disease, who can then be imaged with some of the things to which I've alluded to before. And then at the time of surgery, we can harvest their tissue and then try to backtrack with a series of scientific and basic interventions that allow us to identify these triggers and then test it in a mouse model in the hopes of being able then to translate it into humans. And these are the sort of intersecting circles. It's not just about statins, and obviously ACE inhibitors haven't worked at all, but things like biphosphonates and other things that might interfere with phosphate metabolism. The reason to present this to you is just because I think that this kind of information is exploding, and we actually have an obligation. We need to be very careful not to become so seduced with what we can do technically that we have to begin also to continue to think about natural history and how to intervene at an earlier stage. We want to identify patients, and we also want to manage the health of populations. And eventually, we're going to put things together like this. I don't know if we're going to do this in my lifetime, but wouldn't it be interesting to know whether people who live in Mumbai, for example, where the stress levels are so high and the environment and the air pollution is so dense, whether or not they have different triggers for inflammation that then result in cardiovascular diseases, and whether we can then translate this information to other populations that we see in a prospective way when they come into our office. I think a lot of this is so far away that I can't really even see how to embed it in Epic, but I do think that a center like this, with a high volume of patients and this interchange that you have with basic translational and population research, can help to provide some of these answers. So David, I want to end there, and I want to thank you very much for the opportunity to visit with you.
So I think that everyone now sees why Pat has won all of these teaching awards. Pat, that was fantastic.
Thank you.
I took a page of notes. I'll ask you a couple of questions and then open it up to the floor. The first one is maybe the hardest one, and that's this discussion about asymptomatic patients, which I think is incredibly interesting. And I couldn't agree with you more. When you read the asymptomatic literature, I know the mitral data better than the aortic data, but you just mentioned this paper by Kang on endocarditis. Almost every paper is flawed by inclusion that probably shouldn't have been there. Maurice's paper in 2005, lots of those patients had class one triggers, it's defined today, but that curve still shown as an indication for surgery. So, you know, the more you read those papers, the more you realize that how much we don't know about asymptomatic intervention. But the question I want to focus you on is the comment about reference centers. I wrote that down when you were speaking long before you mentioned it. How do we define reference centers? And the hardest thing is the quality, is the, you know, the transparency about experience, volume, and quality. And we've all gotten used to reading about we're supposed to refer to reference centers, practice in reference centers, and act like reference centers, but no one's had the courage yet to actually put down a number on a piece of paper. What is a reference center, and what should transparency look like? And I think that I'm curious how you see that evolving, and the responsibility for that, of course, is if we do a trial on asymptomatic patients in mitral disease, and you have the 10, sort of, you qualify 10 centers and 15 or 20 surgeons that are really go through this rigorous process, and then you get a good outcome. That, of course, doesn't mean now everyone can do it. That means that those, you know, that group you qualified can do it. And maybe you're right about TAVR. It seems to me there's an inverse relationship. The shorter the procedure, the easier it is to qualify centers and surgeons. There's less decision-making, there's less art to it. Mm-hmm. And I think that it seems like that would be a logical place to start, but I'm curious what you're sort of, can you give us a little more granularity, how you think we should define a reference interventionalist?
Yeah, I think that this is an area that has to be enjoined by credible professional societies in concert with patient advocates CMS or CMMI and major payers, and that it would follow not too follow in some parallel fashion what the American Heart Association tried to put together for Mission Lifeline when we were going through the process of designating STEMI care centers in urban environments. So think about yourself as a hospital president, and you've just come up on a list of hospitals that ambulances will now avoid in order to get to a STEMI center at your expense. Right, so think of what you're going to lose, obviously, in reputation, but also in patient procedures and things of that nature. And I think that's kind of a very granular example of how things can get bogged down in conversations that are actually not necessarily in the best interest of our patients, but become more in the best interest of communities at the expense of patients, institutions at the expense of patients, right? Employees at the expense of patients, and various iterations of that depending upon how darkly you see this kind of calculus. But I think, David, that we are past the time where we need to continue to say we need to know how to define this. It is time to do this. And I know you and Bob wrote that editorial in Jack earlier this year, and it's remarkably similar, right, to what we have been exposed to from our UK colleagues in terms of volume. And I want to know which of you can get out of trouble when a mitral valve repair goes poorly, right? I want to know the same thing about my fellows when I certify them as consulting cardiologists after they leave training. It's not about passing a multiple choice examination. And it could be that we have to get back to being able to see each other under circumstances of duress, and we also need to agree to the rules by which we would report our results, compare our results, and debate it out. But it's so fraught with political danger, people are afraid to engage it. I think we're past time.
Yeah, it's interesting. The trials, I think you're right, that the partner and core valve trials, I think, do give us a blueprint because the inclusion was so carefully defined. And mm-hmm. I think that if you were going to embark, for instance, on an asymptomatic aortic trial, you want to randomize patients. We now know you should have a femoral scan. You should be a candidate only for femoral access. You should have a certain aortic mitral angle. You should have a certain degree. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a degree of calcification or tortuosity we won't accept. Yeah. And if you start defining a population that anatomically sets up well, much like you did on the mitral side, which we've said for years, P2 prolapse is not P2 prolapse. Right. There's simple P2 prolapse, isolated chordal rupture, the rest of the valve normal, and then there's sort of the whole thing is very large and abnormal. Mm-hmm. See, I think the key to an asymptomatic trial, one will be qualifying the interventionalist, and then the other one will be qualifying the anatomy and the pathology to make sure that you're selecting people that if it all goes well, it should really go well. Because yeah. Big responsibility, as you know, from referring patients, it's the lowest risk, highest pressure case, the asymptomatic patient. It's supposed to be perfect every time.
It better be. Otherwise, you won't get another one, right?
Yeah, it's tricky business.
So
high pressure doing asymptomatic.
And most patients are not comfortable yet with the idea that they're feeling fine if they feel confident that they can be watched. But that's our job to make sure that we don't let them fall through the cracks. But I worry, David, I think to sort of put this in real terms, I was in Connecticut last week talking to a group of 60 cardiologists and then hearing about all the new TAVR centers that are ready to open in Connecticut. And I thought, really? It's great. It's really a very exciting field. But, you know, currently there are more than 400 centers reporting to the TVT registry in the United States. We're going down the same pathway we did with PCI. We got so enamored with PCI, right? We have low volume institutions, low volume operators. And then we're always able to win this argument about quality on the basis of the 10 results that you have on an annual basis. And how can we prevent you from executing your professional skills? And it's almost an endless loop argument, unless you stop it at the beginning. 400 centers doing TAVR in the United States. This technology wasn't available, 10 years ago, right? Five.
Yeah. And I'm sure it's soon to be 800. Pat, let me ask you one
question. But plenty of other questions remain, and this is the place to answer them.
Let me ask you one other question before I open up to the floor, and that's an observation about the network trials that I don't think gets enough press. I'm not surprised at all that valve replacement ended up being comparable and maybe even better in severe MR and it's certainly, I think that's the take-home message I've given everywhere, is that do not apologize for doing valve replacement for ischemic disease, and that data set just put an exclamation point on it. But the thing I don't think that we talk enough about is the mortality rates in either arm at 1 year or 2 years. Yeah. To me, this is the most important observation of that trial. These people were definitely qualified with ischemic mitral regurgitation. You can argue about should adjunct techniques or the rings been more pre-specified or things like that, but one thing's for sure, these patients had ischemic MR that was carefully defined, and they had very safe surgery because we know that their early outcome was very good, and their very intermediate survival is very poor.
Yeah.
So I think, to me, this is really an important message in this network trial that's not talked enough about.
So at major academic surgical centers with multidisciplinary heart teams, the one-year mortality for patients with severe ischemic MR approaches 20%. And for patients with moderate ischemic MR, 10%. 10%.
It's worse than having cancer.
Average, I think, median ejection fractions in the moderate ischemic MR group, 45 to 50%, I think, off the top of my head. These are not patients who have advanced systolic LV dysfunction. And that's the message. We are not treating these patients up front. We're not finding them. We're not preventing myocardial infarction, right? We can slay ourselves on many, many different scores. But it's great, again, to be blinded by the technology and sort of lose track of the bigger picture.
Of the actual outcome for the patient. That's why I said I think that one thing that network really showed us is we're far from solving the interventional path. And I don't know what that will be, whether that will be devices, closer follow-up. Is there some signal at 6 months that you're in a group that has an increased mortality at 1 year? But clearly, this is, I think, where that kind of, the ability to get these patient populations defined before they go in, again, not the Kang mistake, but really define patients before they go in by a screening committee, gives you an incredibly valuable natural history tool after intervention.
I think one of the questions for us at this kind of a forum is whether we could ever envision a so-called pragmatic simple trial in cardiac surgical intervention. So what do I mean by that? So the holy grail now in clinical research is to be able to design a trial that can be embedded in routine clinical care and workflow. So there's a trial that's supported by PCORI. I don't know if you're familiar with PCORI, but they're simply looking at whether or not aspirin 325 or aspirin 81 is the right dose for secondary prevention in patients with coronary disease, something that hasn't really been adjudicated. This will be a 20,000 patient study performed over hundreds of sites in the United States simply on the back end of an electronic health record. Patients will be able to be consented online. It's so simple, everybody gets aspirin, it's just a question of the dose, right? And the idea is to be able to complete a study like that in a shorter period of time for less money, and yet ask or answer a public health question. And I don't know what cardiac surgery or interventional cardiology would ever lend itself to that. But if we want to get to the point where we're finding out, are patients living? Are they having heart failure? Are they having atrial fibrillation? We need thousands of patients over that kind of time frame. And I doubt we can scale it up because it's such a special set of interventions. But that's also, I think, the tension.
That's very fascinating because we will, without a model like you just described, we will never know the correct answer about anticoagulation after valve surgery, and which we don't. And there's some centers will anticoagulate a mitral valve repair for 6 months with Coumadin, and some people would do use aspirin. Same thing with aortic valve disease. We'll never have an answer what's the right thing to do.
And we've all had our complications, right? Right. Giving somebody aspirin, and the next thing you know, they have atrial fibrillation, and they don't realize it, and they have a stroke on post-op day 10 while they're at home. Or you do give them warfarin because they have a DVT, and they come back and have hemopericardium and nearly die.
Absolutely. So you've seen, that's why I said I think it's a really interesting concept. Yeah, Pat, I was watching the lecture, and I was thinking to myself about how much changed the last decade.
Yeah.
I mean, if you, it's just, it's you wouldn't have believed it 10 years ago you would have this much information in randomized trials of surgical patients. It's really quite interesting. And syntax, by the way, is the real model, because here, you're right, it may or may not have gotten into the fabric of American medicine. In Europe, it is absolutely the key to reimbursement. You go to meetings in Europe, and you talk about a syntax of 28, they're like, they have to have a CABG or the hospital doesn't get paid.
Right.
You have to go through a process to get reimbursed if your syntax score is high. So I do think this is going to be this is one of those quality initiatives that will come here.
Yeah.
It all comes here. It starts somewhere else, just like resident hours, but it's on its way. And probably for the better, by the way.
Yeah.
I mean, I do think that that's, one way to feel better about the interventions that we do to people. So let me open it up to the floor. Does anybody have a question or a comment for Dr. O'Gara? Ahmed.
Thanks, Dr. O'Gara. So I was interested more in the slide with the title as TAVR introducing a new disease. Because as you're saying, expansion of TAVR, now actually we're getting referred for a patient who needs other procedure.
Yeah.
And they have TAVR.
Yeah.
And a few weeks ago, did this case with Dr. Adams. Patient had an anterior leaflet perforation 2 years after a TAVR from low insertion.
Oh, is that right?
TAVR.
Yeah.
So we opened the aorta, looked at the TAVR, and there is thrombin layer.
No kidding.
Across the three leaflets of the valve.
Really?
We repaired the mitral valve. The patient was a good surgical candidate. He did fine. So
did you leave the aortic valve alone?
Yes.
You just cleaned up the thrombus?
This is important because what we think now, people say stage TAVR then in the future.
Yeah.
That valve was ingrown into the root. The only way to take it out would basically end by degloving the whole root and including the coronaries.
Yeah.
So from the ethical standpoint, I mean, I see the tempo of TAVR is getting very fast, that now we're talking about low-risk patients.
Yeah.
How can this happen within a few years of what thought to be an experimental tool 5 years ago?
I think that's a really good point. And so two thoughts. One is, of course, everyone's anticipating that the cure for a TAVR gone bad is another TAVR. Right? A valve in valve, number one. Number two, we have to remember that the average patient who gets a TAVR in the United States is elderly and has lots of comorbidities that can contribute to valve thrombosis. And that we really only have durability data for 5 years compared to the 15, 20, 25-year durability data that exists in the surgical arena. And I think, frankly, people are expecting that once we hit the 7-year mark, we're going to start to see structural valve deterioration, much like you guys do in current generation bioprostheses. And we begin to see this downturn in incidence of structural valve deterioration. So we're not there yet. But I think the point you're making that needs to be emphasized is this rapid embrace of new technology without knowing all the answers down the road. Yeah.
And the complexity of this, circulatory system that we have, as you said. This was a very impressive layering of platelet layering.
Who would have guessed?
Leaflets. And by the way, we don't look at that many surgical valves 2 years out either. Some of those have the same process going on.
Yeah.
So that may be a reaction to the tissue. Paul?
Well, that was great. Tell me, how do we manage expectations? I mean, we get patients who come in, their primary doctor, their cardiologist says, you should go have a TAVR evaluation. And they're 65 years old and have no risk factors.
Right.
Like you said, patients are happy to have an inferior result for if they don't have to have their chest open.
Right, even if it's not in their best interest.
Even if it's not in their best interest. And then you tell them, have you got $100,000 you can lay down on the table and go pay for it in Germany or something? You can't do that in this country. And yet you have, the patient expectations and the doctor's expectations. Or you have a patient who, an 86-year-old guy I saw yesterday, has a STS score written in the cath report of 2.5%. And so what do they do? Previous intervention So they did another two more drug-eluting stents in the LAD in preparation for TAVR.
Mm-hmm.
And then they asked for a surgical consult.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, just
so that's not a surgical consult.
Just to rubber stamp the TAVR.
It is, those are expectations that have already been pre-managed.
Well, I think that you're bringing up a very, very important point, two important points. One is the expectations with patients and families. And secondly is how it is that we actually function as a multidisciplinary heart team. So you're providing an example that is universal, your second example. It's universal that decisions are made, right, out of earshot of an open multidisciplinary assessment. Because we're all so busy. You guys are in the operating room, we're in the cath lab, somebody's in the echo lab, and the next thing you know, well, you know, we did the last couple like this, we're going to do the drug-eluting stent, and then we're going to do the TAVR, we hope you agree. And so that begs the question about how it is that you can maximize the functionality of a multidisciplinary heart team in real time. Because you know, you don't want me calling you for nothing, right? And especially if I fail to appreciate that the ascending aorta is calcified. No? Right? But sometimes it looks to me like it's slightly calcified. Other times it's, you know, pretty obvious, and so some surgeons have a different appetite for ascending aortic calcification, and some like to replace the ascending aorta. I don't know. So, and your first point, I think that we need to be as strict as possible, and that is that surgery is the gold standard. Okay, and I only know about durability for 5 years, and paravalvular leak, as far as I can tell, is a bad thing, and I don't know whether you're going to get it or not. Or something like that. And there are plenty of other places that might treat you differently, but that usually ends the conversation with a young person. It usually ends the conversation.
Bonnie, you've been waiting patiently.
Sorry.
Just one problem with surgical studies is that heart surgery is very rarely life-saving, other than for something like endocarditis, aortic dissection. So when you look at valve surgery,
yeah,
or coronary disease, the benefits are long-term,
yeah,
improved life expectancy.
Right.
And the problem with a lot of the trials we have of heart surgery is for the reason you said, investigators can't do trials that will last 15 years because they'll be either dead or retired by the time it publishes. So you publish results at 1 year or 2 years, but really the impact or difference of surgery can't be detected generally for a much longer time period. For example, the stitch trial, which you mentioned, published in 2011 and showed there was no benefit of coronary revascularization in severe LV dysfunction.
Right.
And just last month in the New England Journal, they now published another paper saying, oh no, well, we got it wrong. We've now followed the patients. The two curves that were together at 2 years have separated by 8 years and big separation. And they're now saying, actually, your long-term survival is better if you have coronary bypass surgery and LV dysfunction.
Right.
But yet a lot of practice had already changed from the previous trial. And the problem with a lot of these surgical trials is that we won't know whether valve repair is useful in moderate MR for another 4 or 5 years. But by then, the decisions are made, the guidelines are changed, everyone has forgotten the trial, and the network might not even exist to follow up the patients or whichever investigators did. So how do we get around that? Because it's impossible to
design
long-term clinical trials.
You're right on every score, every score. And thanks for emphasizing that. I think that it seems to me that it's a matter of money, funding, and a critical mass. But those are the questions to which a cardiologist wants answers. Does my patient live longer, have heart failure, have atrial fibrillation, etc.? And the stitch trial, unfortunately, the 10-year outcome data from the stitch trial, if you think about how much notoriety it has achieved, it's about a 1 on a scale of 10 compared against the 9 out of 10 that happened around the time of the original publication of the stitch trial. So I think the average person doesn't pay any attention to the 10-year outcome. Or they'll look at it and say, well, you only followed half your patients or some combination of that. It's like our society in general, isn't it? And we're just so fascinated on the instant. Our minds are made up.
But Peyton, I've had that conversation with Anatine. I think this is one of the things that the network has to win in Washington, which is the ability to follow any of these trials for a decade. Yeah. Because like Ani said, yeah, it would be a shame to have all these patients in any of those trials that have been entered so carefully and not understand what happens to them over the next decade, because there'll be other things we're going to learn from those patients, yeah, following them. So I think they've just got to, you know, give
incremental knowledge will be low.
And they've got to fund that. It's, yeah, got to be in. It's got to be preserved, the chance to follow those patients.
Absolutely.
Farzan, you had a question?
Yeah, sorry. I really enjoyed your presentation, particularly your last slide when you showed the global aspect, yeah, of the problem on the individuals. And I think you are probably familiar with the last piece of information, which was the headline of Washington Post 2 days ago, with the widespread of electronic chart in the United States. Now, there are data suggesting that the third cause of mortality in U.S. are medical errors, mm-hmm, with an estimate, low estimate, at 250,000 to 300,000 deaths a year. Now, if you take that as a global risk, as a leader in clinical medicine, how do you integrate that from that big number to excellence of surgery in asymptomatic patients?
Well, that's a very good question, Farzan. I think it speaks to the fact that we don't know what we don't know, number one, right? And that we all have inflated ideas as to how good we are. And it just, I think, gets back to the need to define, measure, and then act on measurements that are transparent, that resonate as being relevant, can be externally validated, and easily captured in the course of routine workflow. And I also think that it demands that each of us continue to elevate safety as job one when we come to the hospital every day. It's so easy for things to fall through the cracks. I actually think the electronic health record has made things worse rather than better, at least in my own practice. Yeah, because I'm cross-eyed by the time I finish a day now. I have too much eye strain, and so then there's a fatigue factor. I'm sure you get the fatigue factor if you've been standing in the OR for 8 hours under those hot lights and somebody's aortic dissection falls apart and you get tired, and you have to, right? And then your outcome is not as good as if you were fresh. So something happens.
Well, it's the problem is, Pat, you spend more time at that computer than you do at the bedside. That's, yeah, the problem. I mean, it's all accessible, yeah, but there are a lot of FTEs that go into, you know, a lot of, you know, care hours from every member of the team that goes into that record now that used to be, you know, more straightforward. Yeah. John, let me give you the last question, then we'll stop, because we have a clinical, we're going to have a few presentations for Dr. Aguirre next. Let me give you the last question.
First, Pat, I'd like to thank you for being here today,
and thanks,
especially for your immense contribution to the NIH Cardiothoracic Surgical Trials Network. Many of you don't know, but Pat is really the central intellectual engine of our network, in partnership with a lot of other smart, hardworking people, but his contributions have been immense. Last question really relates to, Peter Block was here 2 days ago giving grand rounds in cardiology downtown at the Beth Israel.
Yeah.
We were talking about early evidence of 3 to 4 years out TAVR structural valve degeneration being in the 6, 7, 8% range, depending. Where do you see those curves going? Will those curves be strikingly less long-lived than present generation surgical valves? Will they resemble the oldest bovine pericardial valves, first generation valves that were sort of catastrophic in the surgical realm? Or will these plateau? What do you think?
Well, that's a really hard question, because I'm not a material science guy, as you know. And what we do know are just the 5-year data that Mike Mack published. But my intuition is, John, that if you put one of these valves and crimp it on the end of the catheter, you got to be messing it up in some way. It seems to me that that's a lot different than off the shelf in terms of its ability to withstand the wear and tear of the circulation over a comparable period of time, unless these wizards have figured that out. But I would be very concerned about something that looks like this and then goes like that, just on the basis of you know, what's under my car or a bed spring or something in the couch, right? But we'll find out, and we absolutely have to find out. Maybe that'll put the brakes on this enthusiasm that we have, infatuation. Thank you.
Pat, thanks again.
Thanks
a lot. It's great.
Thank you.